David Hasselhoff. Or as most of you know me, Mitch Buchanan of the world's most watched television show, Baywatch. You know, Baywatch is driven by a lot of vital elements, all working together in high-tech precision. There are the life and death stories of rescue by the brave lifeguards who work the California coast. There's the sun and the fun image of Southern California with its pounding surf and great-looking men and women. But underlying it all, there's the music of Baywatch, including the musical montages created for every single episode. On our special Baywatch Music Fest, we will take you behind the scenes to show you how the music of Baywatch is made. As a matter of fact, we're in the studio right now, getting ready to cut some songs for the show with our very own Jeremy Jackson, who plays my son, Hobie, on Baywatch. You know, the process of making a Baywatch music video involves a lot of people working long hours to create great sounds and images, all of which add up to just a few moments of poetic perfection. But for our music video makers, this isn't work. This is art in action. Music is such a big part of Baywatch, and so many of our actors are talented singers, that we decided to create an album featuring the music from the show, sung by the stars of the show. Before there was Pearl Jam, Whitney Houston, or Baywatch, before the Beatles, before the Stones, before even the Grateful Dead, there were the Beach Boys, creating a magical place called Southern California and songs like Surfin' USA, and Surfer Girl, the songs that gave birth to the golden age of beach music. And the Beach Boys were followed by Frankie and Annette, Jan and Dean, Ricky Nelson, and scores of others who glorified the lifestyle of Southern California. Of the dozens of music videos created here at Baywatch, some of the best feature the music of one of our favorite acts, a group that helped create the Baywatch sound called TAG. Hello, America! Is probably the most important thing in my life, other than growing as an actor. I cannot sit in my car without listening to music. I cannot take a shower without listening to music. I cannot get through an episode of Baywatch without making sure that the music is driving the show. So I think music plays a major role in my life. The singer that influenced me the most as a child was Sammy Davis Jr. He had a fantastic voice, a great charisma. Later on in life, I went on to become a friend of his. At first, I was his waiter at the Marina City Club, and then I was in a series called The Young and the Restless, where I played a character named Snapper, and he actually came to visit the set one day. And we and I became friends and gave me a lot of very good advice. You know, people say, well, how do you like being a pop star, a rock star, or an actor? I basically say, I'm not really any of those. I'm an entertainer. I see myself as a Sammy Davis or a male Liza Minnelli, or like Freddie Mercury was with Queen. He had a terrific amount of energy, and that's what I want to do. I mean, there's so many facets to this business, like we're talking about in this special about music and how music plays such a part in everyone's life and how universal it is. And I think that my future really is in entertaining.
The sun in your eyes, the warmth of your smile. This is the summer of love.
My singing and acting are different elements of my life, and if I can marry them together, great. And I've found a way to marry them together now, because I've grown as a pop singer, and the music's coming from my heart now, and
before it was a live song that was strictly for just one market, me in Germany. Now this music is becoming more of a part of me, which is more of a part of Mitch Buchanan on Baywatch, so I'm kind of putting the two together. Drumming on stage is about as close to heaven as you can possibly get when you're backstage and you've got 10,000 people chanting your name, David, David, David. And then you have to go on stage and you look out and you embrace this magnificent energy of people looking at you, and you take them on a two-hour ride. It's incredible. It's also full of major sacrifices, because at one point I was on stage when my baby was being born in Los Angeles, because she came 6 weeks early, and it was the highest and saddest moment of my life. But that entire 15,000 people in Frankfurt will never forget it nor will I, because they shared in the moment of the announcement of my child, and we all were there sort of playing little children's songs and lullaby and goodnight, and it was an amazing sense of love that from this moment in my life, which was 4 years ago when she was born, every single time I go back to Frankfurt, people walk up to me and said, I was there on that amazingly emotional moment of when your child was born. So it really is quite a connection of love all in the same room. Last season I did a very special song that was written by Glenn Ballard and Bruce Levine and Renee Moore, called The Best Is Yet to Come. And it's a song that was incorporated into an absolutely awesome Baywatch called The Child Inside, where we had about 100 mentally handicapped children on the show from the Special Olympics, where they were competing.
Try to feel it from the other side. Come.
The name showed this video. God is seeing the thing from the other side. Don't forget where you come from. What went down before doesn't matter now. The best is yet to come. Showed these children running in the sand and swimming and running with a torch and having heart and hope against all adversity, playing my song in the background. And it was quite moving. One of the reasons that I'm successful in is because I like to communicate with the audience. I like to reach out and say, hello, how are you? I'm happy that you're here. I'm happy that you paid to come and see me. Let's join in and have fun together. My first dress rehearsal, the average age was 75 years old, but I had those ladies rocking, and they were out there, you know. I took them away from their little one-arm bandits for the slot machines for, you know, a good hour and 45 minutes, and they actually stayed for my whole show. But it's really communication. I think that's what a lot of the entertainers have. They affect the audience, whereas a lot of concerts, they basically get up there and they play, and there's a wall between the audience and themselves, and I think it's quite apparent at times. With me, my greatest compliment was I went to East Germany behind the wall, before the wall was down, and I said, hi, and I said, do you know me as the man who talks to the car? They went, man who talks to the car? You crazy? No, you're a singer. And they knew me only as a singer, and it really moved me, because I realized that I had something to offer, that I had made it on the strength of my song and my voice, and not the pre-existing David Hasselhoff fever that, you know, preceded many of the other countries. I'm not sure that I'm going to keep pursuing this passion to be a pop singer, but I will continue to be an entertainer. I will really try to follow in the steps of my main man, Sammy Davis Jr., and do some more musical theater.
The gels and liquid medication.
Without music, I think Baywatch would still be a great show. But thanks to the music videos that appear every week, you know, it's becoming something more. It's becoming a bridge between cultures around the world. On Baywatch, life isn't just a beach. Life is also a beat that never ends. I'm David Hasselhoff, reminding you to please keep watching and keep listening to Baywatch. Thanks.